We have all been there. You think your students have it, they're off working independently, and then all of a sudden you start to see one hand raise, and then another hand, and then another hand, and you realize they have hit the point where they are doing the story problems. I'm Christina Tondevold, the Recovering Traditionalist, and I hope that you'll stick around as I have a special guest today, Ann Elise Record, who is going to talk to us about addition and subtraction word problems for elementary kids in our quest to build our math minds so that we can build the math minds of our kiddos. Now, in this video, Ann Elise is going to be talking about something special that we are doing together. It's a mini course that she is doing just on addition and subtraction word problems. And if you think that that is just for the young kiddos, boy, are you wrong, because number one, our upper kids really struggle with this stuff, but they still see story problems. It's just with decimals and fractions. And so now we have all these different layers of story. They're not good at story problems to begin with, and then they're struggling with decimals and fractions, and it just becomes really overwhelming to them. So she's going to be talking about that mini course she's doing, but I want you to think about what she's talking about in this video and how you can apply it in your class, whether or not you take the mini course with her or not. So I'm gonna let her chat about those things, and then I'm gonna come back on and kind of give you my takeaways of what we should be doing in the classroom. Because even though she's talking about what she's gonna be talking about in the mini course, these are the things that we should be doing in our classroom to help our kids with addition and subtraction word problems. All right, so here is Ann Elise.
Hi everyone, I'm Ann Elise Record, and I'm an independent math consultant, and part of my work is to work with Christina Tondevold on her Build Math Mind site, creating content, videos, and resources for the educators within her community. And in this course, this mini course, we're going to be focusing on word problem types that involve addition and subtraction. Now, I know that it sounds like it should be easy, addition and subtraction word problems, how hard could that be? But let me tell you, there is a lot of complication to it, and particularly to help be able to build our own math mind so that we can then build the math minds of our students for sure. Now, when I taught fifth grade in elementary classroom for 13 years, I would give assignments to my students, and I knew that as soon as they get out of their seat to come talk to me and they'd say, "I don't get it," I knew it was the first word problem on the page. I knew I was able to teach them the procedures and the skills, and then they would get to the one that actually had the application problem where it was a word problem, and they did had zero perseverance, didn't even know where to begin. And then I would try to help them. And I do remember I gave them highlighters, they highlighted the numbers and they highlighted the keywords, and I had a gorgeous keyword poster up on my wall. And I thought that, and the students thought that, the kids were doing fine. Once they could take out those numbers, pluckers, as Graham Fletcher calls them, and then look at the keyword poster to see what operation they should do, and then they calculate their answer. Now, I was successful in that because the questions that I gave them all had the results unknown. So the keywords worked. But now that we know so much more about how kids learn as they learn and grow, particularly about word problems, and based on the research of Thomas Carpenter and his colleagues called Cognitive Guided Instruction, there are actually lots of different problem types that involve addition and subtraction. And we can't just keep teach keywords anymore because the unknowns could be at any spot. So looking for the word more does not necessarily mean I'm going to add the numbers together. So not only did I do a disservice to my students by not letting them become persevering and problem solving and really doing the work of mathematicians, I was trying to help them, and I loved them, and I wanted to support them and have them be successful. But I realize now I cringe at the thought, because I know I did nothing to help them become problem solvers and critical thinkers and whatnot. So I've designed this course so we can explore the word problem types together. Now, as I present seminars, I do ask my participants, how many problem types do they think that there are that involve just adding and subtracting? And I get numbers ranging from 2 to 4, sometimes 6, but I rarely hear many people offer the 15 that there actually are. And when you add in multiple step problems, so 2-step and then multi-step problems that we want by the end of grade 2, there are 20. So if we don't know what these problem types are, how on earth are we going to be able to teach them to our students and prepare them for the foundation that we really expect that are in our standards? So want to make sure that we're covering in the course all the different varieties of problem types that there are. And then once we know about the different problem types, I then want to talk about the modeling of them. The modeling of them helps the structure of the word problem become in a visual way very clear in our minds. Now, I've lived this myself. I know that I have read particularly comparison problem types, and my mind would get confused. Like, am I trying to look for the larger number, the small? Do I add? Do I subtract? But now that I'm working with these models, I particularly love the tape diagram model. When I work with these, I now visually see the structure of the word problem, and it becomes really much easier for my brain to figure out what I need to do. And these structures, the beauty of it is the structures remain the same throughout the years of the grade levels of the kids. What changes is the calculation of the multi-digit numbers or the fractions and decimals down the road. But very often, I'll be reading a word problem given to students, let's say in grade 5, and it's a comparison problem type. Only it has fractions in them, but it's still a comparison problem type. So if we were able to build the foundation of the word problem structures for our kiddos K2, they're set up for success in their future math journeys. So it really can become a really powerful way for us to teach the kids problem solving in a way that goes to the underlying structure of the problem. So students aren't just going to read a problem and then give up and say, oh, I don't get it because it has words. They really can understand what's going on in the word problems and understand and then have that flexibility of how they want to calculate the answer. So let's take for an example a word problem, like a takeaway problem. So if I have 15 cupcakes and I gave away 8 of them to my friends, how many would I have left? Well, now that's a takeaway thought process, so it does encourage me. And as students begin learning about the problem types, that takeaway method, it encourages them to think about taking away from the 15. So if I have my 15, I'm taking away 8 from that, how much is left? But I can also think about that as a missing add-end problem. So I can think, well, something plus 8 must make the 15. And I can even start at the 8 and count up to the 15 if I want to. Even though the problem type is a takeaway problem type, I could use attraction to solve it. And by being able to focus on the structures and create models for these problem types, we're then freeing up our students to compute in ways that make sense to them and using whatever strategies that they want to use. And it's beautifully embedding within the understanding of the inverse relationship of addition and subtraction. We are talking about things like the commutative property of addition. I mean, all these mathematical things are embedded within this work. I love also focusing on the meaning of equality, that it means the same as, that both sides of an equation need to be balanced, like they were going to be balancing, if you have one of those plastic balances. So it's so much mathematics is embedded within this and so much sophistication to it. And it takes time to learn that journey. So our hope is that by the end of grade 2, students would have these addition and subtraction word problem types mastered so that we can go on to multiplication and division ones in grade 3, 4, 5. But the problem types are not going to go away. They're going to have decimals and fractions and multi-digit numbers. So it's really important we're creating that foundation of knowledge for our students. So in the mini course, we'll be talking about all the varieties of problem types that there are. There are 4 basic types, but then of course it gets more complicated when we have the unknown being at each spot. So talk about what happens when those are happening and how we can visualize these using models. What kind of materials can we use concretely and then pictorially and then finally abstractly using equations to be able to model the structure of what's going on in the word problems. And then talk about the equations and the mathematics that can be done to compute the answer. Now again, math isn't all just about getting right answers. But of course, we do want to be able to successfully come to a right answer. So talk about what kind of possibilities there are for equations, because those are the choices that our students have to come to an answer that makes sense to them and see whether it's reasonable. Now, I'll also be providing you with an assessment that you can give your students to be able to see what areas are in need of them. We don't want to always give them an add to problem type where the result is unknown. Why take time classroom? Our time is too valuable to take that up if most of the students have that kind of problem type down. We want to be able to be aware of what are the strengths and areas of weakness in our classroom so we can respond instructionally, both as a whole group and as a small group, in order to meet the needs of all the students. So I'll be providing you an assessment that you can give to see where the strengths are of your students. We can be able to build on that and develop a plan to meet the needs of all your students. I'll also include a data file that you'll be able to organize your data to really see exactly where the needs are, both as an entire classroom, but also how you can zoom in small group time to work with the kids. So there's a lot that is involved within these addition and subtraction word problem types. I certainly hope that you will join me, and particularly to build your own math mind so you feel comfortable with it, so that we can then turn around and be able to help our students and create that foundation of learning so they're not afraid to work on any word problems. And in fact, they'll be proud to get out of their seats and show you how they figured it out, as opposed to saying, I don't know how to get, I don't get this. I don't know. So please join me. I look forward to seeing you, and take care.
All right. Thank you so much, Ann Elise. I love learning with Ann Elise. But here's my big takeaways from what she talked about, what she's going to be doing in the course. So if you're not going to take the course, here's the things that I picked up that we need to be doing around word problems with our kids. Number one, we have to, as the teacher, understand the different story problem types. It's not very necessary that kids can name these story problem types, but as teachers, we better know what types are out there so that we know whether or not kids are able to solve those. Are our textbooks actually including all of these different story problem types? Because our assessments actually are. So you need to be able to analyze your textbook to show, are they only ever showing the result unknown story problem types, or are they exposing kids to all the other types? So you need to know what those problem types are, and then you can look for those things in your classroom. The second takeaway I had was that modeling these story problems is crucial. It is not just giving a story problem and having kids write the equation that goes with it. Kids need to really understand and be able to model the problem with manipulatives and draw pictures. Well, and actually don't have them draw pictures, because if they're in first grade and kindergarten, they will draw elaborate pictures. I talk about it as drawing models of the problem. So kids need that, or else they become number pluckers, as Graham Fletcher calls them. We don't want kids just plucking out the numbers and trying to write the equation to solve. They need to model and truly understand what the story problem is asking them. Now, the big piece of that is being able to connect those models to the equations. So yes, we do want kids to connect an equation to it, but you're not just jumping straight to that. And then the last big takeaway was being able to assess to see how the kids are doing on story problems, because that's totally different than just the bare problems. Like, you will see kids who can do bare problems and then can't do a story problem. That was me when I was growing up. Give me 30 to 50 problems, because that's the way textbooks were. I could solve every single one of those bare problems, and then I would skip the story problems. But it's not that I didn't understand the mathematics. I could do the math. I could do the arithmetic. Let me be careful on that. I could do the arithmetic, but I really wasn't understanding how mathematics applied to my real life. And that's what story problems are about. So it's really digging into, are kids able to apply this in real life settings? Those are the big takeaways I hope you got from Ann Elise's video here. If you want help with those big ideas, come join Ann Elise in her mini course. If not, then do those on your own. I don't care if you take Ann Elise's course or not, but I want you guys to be able to do those things. And if you want help with that, come join Ann Elise in the course. All right, so I hope that that video helped you build your math mind so you can go build the math minds of your students. Have a great day.